now I'm more than happy to introduce Daria Muehlethaler. We've had a long history with Swisscom API, with the program from 2013, and now your pragmatic approach to an API ecosystem. Go on.
Thanks everybody for being here. So let's get started. I'm happy to give you some insights on how we work with APIs. So let me quickly introduce the company to you. Crealogix is a Swiss software provider. We do digital banking solutions for different banks, both online banking and mobile banking. And we are quite for a while in the industry as a pure play provider for the front end. So why do we work with APIs and why they're so important to us? As you obviously could see, of course, online banking is a huge topic nowadays. You have these two regulations, but a lot of banks do want to jump on the opportunity with fintechs or create own solutions. But also you would see that we serve different type of banks. So we have retail banks, wealth management, and also business offerings. And they are all a bit different. So what a little private bank needs, it's not the same what a huge retail bank needs and has today, obviously. And it's also not the same what a little retail bank would need, obviously something out of the box. While bigger banks have their own infrastructures, and private banks, they always want to implement their own roadmaps, implement their features, they want to differentiate themselves. So how do we sort all of them? Of course, we want to have a product. We don't want to have like 100 products for any customers. How do you create a product while actually being able to serve them also? And that's where the APIs come in place and help us. That's about the company. Let's talk about banks. So of course, banks have a digital transformation on their agenda, and it comes with the reasons why they want to do that. So obviously, it's all about differentiation as well, right? For now, they have a value proposition towards the customers, it's quite similar among different players. I mean, let's look at the example of the retail bank. So what you can do, you can go online, you can do your payments, probably have a savings account there and so on. But it's all quite similar. And moving on with more players from fintechs, of course banks also want to differentiate their value propositions. Within an ecosystem, you can do it not only towards the customer, you can also differentiate your value proposition among the different players. So there are more possibilities to do so and to be a bit different. But of course, looking at what they want to achieve, there's a lot of things they want to achieve for customers, customer convenience, they want to hide the complexity, but also simplify customer journey. All things you've probably seen in other industries. And then talking about own ecosystem. So talking about ecosystem, you know, quickly talk about partners, right? And about integration, which comes with APIs. Probably you would start with kind of client integration, for example, for marketing again programs. Easily integrate some offerings, then you kind of push on the button, and then you jump over to other application, and then continue there. But with some time and with some experience, they would also like to improve the user journey and the user experience, which means they have to integrate deeper. And for that, latest at this point, I would say, you should really think how your architecture looks like. And how you're gonna organize actually your tech stack. So what we do, we have this decoupling microservices, of course, with the runtime, with these building blocks, with business logic and the front end from top. And these are all opportunities where you can connect via the APIs. how your ecosystem would look like, right? So there are lots of solutions out there for all possible banking, near banking solutions. Like you can do crowdfunding, that's something relatively new to the banks, of course, blockchain solutions. But other more traditional ones, down the gateway, mortgage lending, lending insurance, and so on. So you can, basically there's so many of them, and you can connect by APIs on different layers. Maybe you want to include some identity providers in your offering. Actually, your customers will never see the APIs, but profit from your overall solution. Maybe you need to add some business logics or additional feature from someone like messaging or whatever, which is not your core business, or you just work on the front end layer and integrate directly. So there are many many possibilities how to deal with APIs, and of course it might be a bit confusing. So where should we start? What should we do? And maybe maybe we can consume a lot of APIs, but maybe we can also expose a lot of APIs, right? So it's easily about like the exposure of APIs, and you've heard also a lot about public APIs, so it's also a huge trend. Also, PC2, you have to expose some APIs, but what can easily happen is that the bank gets unbundled, which means that there are a lot of fintechs that are very thankful that banks expose their payments, accounts, contracts, and so on, and they can pick it up and be a great solution quickly, right? So for the banks, it's really important to create and orchestrate their own ecosystem. But also, while doing so, you can also learn how to deal with different partners and which use cases are actually right for you. So while of course some strategy departments would look at the APIs and API programs that drives you as an anchor company what's best to do, and in the ecosystem, of course, you know, you can take a different role, right? You can be a marketplace, or you can be a backend services provider, or you can jump on the front end and really try to do great front ends and user experiences. So what's the best for you right now? It's all a bit iterative. How do you find out what's the best approach to start with? I would say it's definitely worth trying different things first. If you have an opportunity to participate in the marketplace, great. If you can expose one of your backend services, great, and so on. So this gives you an opportunity to learn what works for you in the end, and if you decide then, fine, we don't want to do marketplace, we actually want to build our own front ends, then it just takes less time and money to actually go into other direction as building one direction from the beginning and find out that actually it's not what you want. Fine, let me see. Good. With this question, where should we start? So we're still there, and they would say start with existing partners. Every company already has a partner, many partners. So why not actually start with someone who you already have in your ecosystem and who you definitely trust? As trust is actually the most important prerequisite for ecosystem and for working with APIs. I'm changing to another slide, so you will definitely see here a bunch of reasons why to start with existing partners. Let me go quickly through. Like I said, trust is the most important one. You already know someone, and with APIs, just to mention, especially you give access to the data. I mean, it's always critical. No one wants really to export their data. You never know what happens. So if you already know your partner, you are more likely to trust them with data. Then, of course, you have existing contracts. You don't have to think about, okay, what they will support, how do they work, what are some commercial implications. It's already there. So, from the business model, with the APIs, many players try to find out first what their use cases should be and what their business model should be. So basically, it's already, it's more easy for you because you are in the proven space. Now, of course, employees always help to create a business model and implementation plans. Again, imagine you have APIs and you have to create a monetization strategy. So what does it mean? How much do you charge? In the beginning, it's difficult to know how much, but if you have your track records, you know what would be a great offer to your partners or to someone else. And not to forget, adding new value through APIs is a really good place to start with, although because if you just say, yeah, I have partners, I've been integrated, and now I want to do it with APIs, so who is going to pay for it? If you can prove your features and new value, it's more easier to get everyone on board. So, what I'm showing to you now is actually how we try to understand what our customers want and need. And just let me go quickly back here. Right. So, what we actually look at, we look at the fintech collaboration journey. So, we want to understand how our customers, banks, work with their fintechs and how we can actually help them with as a technology partner. While we are doing that, of course, you could, for example, build a marketplace, integrate a lot of fintechs yourself, and then offer to the banks. But I'm not sure it works for every bank, for every customer. Just let's have a look. So, when a bank comes up with a need or with an idea to build something, they would probably look for a partner on the market, and probably there is no startup of fintech which can feed the need exactly like the bank wants it to. So they would probably do an RFI with three or four startups and actually ask them for the offering structure, ask them for some information, maybe do a proof of concept before doing the contract. After the contract, would they would go on the integration journey. So they would really look at what the value proposition is, how to adjust product idea, or how to adjust APIs, and integrate, obviously. So that's the process. And in this process, it needs both parties, right? So it needs the bank, who is also ready to say, well, maybe we're not getting 100% of our solution, we're getting like 70 now, but what needs to happen next? And you need also the startup index and find this APIs for our offering, but obviously we also need to move in the direction of the bank. After the go live, you would also continue with your collaboration, right? So you would exchange the roadmaps, you probably have got, or even build the roadmaps yourself. You would do product enrichment and again go down this different integration. So that's all fine, but with the APIs, how do you support it from the APIs perspective? And for that, there's this other one. You have to support this journey on the adequate pace, actually. So let's say you're in the beginning and you say, I want to have all these great fintechs onboarded and I want to have to API company. And then probably someone from the technical department would go and see if there are some API management platforms out there or how we are going to support it. But in the beginning, you obviously don't need it all yet. So what in the beginning needed probably just API documentation, maybe even sent via email, but it needs to happen tomorrow. With the fintechs, it's very easy. They have no time to lose and no money to lose, obviously. If they see that this is a huge corporate which takes 2 years to integrate their solution, they just don't have the possibility to do so. So it's better to move here at the right space and give them things which they need now. There's like API documentation, so probably you would have here some specifications, your YAML files. You would also create some high-level solution design. Then you would need to move to the next step, which is giving the opportunity to develop and adjust against your sandbox or test environment. And so on. And next would be the lifecycle management. Here you need more mature products, right? and other UAS integration. Now, when you have just one or two partners, it's easy to do it even manually. But if you have many, then you need to start thinking about all the forums, all the community, and so on. It just doesn't make sense to think about if you just have two. Fine. And of course, you have to give them give the index access to your API catalog, which is hopefully growing. Because here, they will also see what's up on your roadmap and see an inspiration for their product. So maybe you have two or three APIs, you wouldn't think that they fit this partner, but they would see the opportunity and actually they give you inspiration for you. Now speaking of fintechs, we have a wish list from fintechs what they think is important when working with us or with banks. And you'll probably recognize many things here, but it's good to see them again as well. It's again starts with documentation. You can think by now, everybody should know that yeah, the documentation needs to be clear, it needs to be there, it needs to be clicked and validated. Still not the case. You should also provide implementation possibilities as well as test environments to develop against. Sometimes it's difficult, so not all banks would open their test environments and let fintechs to do something there. Then think about sandbox. In-built features helps a lot, so you might see example implementation, everything what helps the fintech to move on quickly. So if you can add some additional features that which really helps them to implement the product to make it better, just go ahead. And single sign-on is something which is, of course, really great for the solutions. Maybe you have also some other features to support here. They will be really great. So for now, you've seen what our banks actually want to build and what our fintechs want to have. And of course, it's not only about tools and documentations, it's all that our banks want to have the APIs themselves to build their frontends themselves. And this is great. We're really happy they want, because there are more APIs and more people who can deal with APIs the better. What does it mean for us? We also need to move forward one step to support them on their journey. And we are going to become an orchestration platform for them. I will just show you the second one. Good. Ecosystem is all about win-win situations, right? And we need to provide possibilities for everybody to blossom. But let's see the journey. So today we are in the online banking world. And this is a direct relationship with the customer. Now we are moving into this open banking world, where you would have the third party applications integrated, like in messaging, something along the value chain of the customer. You would have the fintechs, which help you or even provide better experience with something. You would also have all these great technologies which are happening. And this all enables you to tailor your solution towards the customers. It helps you to aggregate features and offer them exactly to their market segment, which is more responsive to this offer. But the next step would actually be that every customer should be able to build their own ecosystem. So banks would be just a fragment or friction in their journey or in their ecosystem. They might add things from travel, from finance, from retail, whatever they need, and the combination they need. And how are you going to ensure that? So for sure, you will need an orchestration platform to do so. But this is really a couple of steps ahead. And what we do, and what we all need to do now, this is really to move in the right space so we can take everybody on board and